What's up, everyone? Welcome to NS Game Review CCG Edition, and you might be wondering a little bit why the camcorder is looking a different direction this time. That is because of the game I am reviewing this month, the playmat, which is actually kind of useful for this game, definitely will not fit on my desk. So I kind of have to record everything on the corner of my bed, and I figured it would be easier instead of constantly moving the tripod back and forth, to just kind of leave it in one area, and it's kind of adjust the height and turn it around as need be. Henceforth, why you're looking at me from a different direction than normal. Usually I have my computer in front of me, my TV in front of me, and now it's behind me. But the game I'm taking a look at this month is one I tried to take a look at a couple times, kind of like Guardians. And I would start to understand it, and then I would start reading the advanced parts of it and kind of start confusing myself. But the more I actually looked at it, the more I don't know why I was confused, and that is MLB Showdown 2000. I figured it's the we're getting around time of the MLB postseason, so why not? Initially, I was going to do this in October until I realized, well, at that point, the season's over, so might as well do it now. And so this was made in, well, naturally, around 2000 by, believe it or not, Wizards of the Coast. Which might explain some of the complexity I was feeling when I was first trying to do this a while back. So, the long story short, this video is going to be slightly different, but not that much. I'm still going to go into the card types first, which is only a couple. And this will be the longest card type segment I've ever done, because I've already got it recorded. But I should have split it into cards and or card types and mechanics this time. I really should have. But so this card type segment ends up being almost 8 minutes long. I'm just going to forewarn you. And most of it's going to be a bunch of little tidbits about the cards themselves, how various things on the cards work. And that's pretty much why I didn't split it into card types and mechanics, because they are technically mechanics, but at the same time, they're also talking about the cards themselves. It sounds strange until you actually see it. But after that, I'll go into how the game is played, and this is where things are going to get a little different, because this game has three different rule sets: basic, advanced, and expert. The basic rules are incredibly basic. They are made to work with the starter set, regardless of the cards you get. I'm guessing the decks you get are the exact same, regardless of what starter you get. The advanced rules throw in a few more things, and you could probably still do most of the advanced stuff with the starter decks. Because it basically just throws in strategy cards, a few other things here or there, such as like innings pitched. And then we get into the expert rules, which throws in a few more things. And if you really want to go by the expert rules, you cannot play the starter set with the expert rules. The big thing being that requires, well, I talk about in deck construction, you need at least four starting pitchers. I can't remember how many relievers or closers. A lineup of 20 players. You have to make sure every position is covered. And if I combined the two starter decks it comes with, which are both very small, there's only like 11 players each. Sorry, 12 players each, I believe, including two pitchers for both the National League and the American League. I could cover every position. It definitely wouldn't be the required number of players, though, that I need total. But beyond that, I'm going to split that into talking about the basic rules and showing how a basic game is played. I'm then going to go into the advanced rules, and there's not a whole lot of play difference I can talk about, though I go ahead and play an inning or so with strategy cards, and I show a couple things like how to steal and stuff like that, talk about base advancement. And then after that, I just go straight into explaining the expert rules, and Again, there's not really much gameplay to show off the expert rules. But I'm going to try to break it down like that. If you are confused at all at the end of any of that, I don't blame you. You can feel free to leave a comment in the video, and I will do my best to answer for you. But with that, let's go and get on to the different card types. MLB Showdown only uses two types of cards, player and strategy. However, each of those two types has two or three subtypes. For the record, a lot of what I'll be talking about here, especially in deck construction, will mostly apply to the advanced and expert rules. The most important of the two types are the players. Naturally, since you're putting together a baseball team, you'll have players for all sorts of positions on the field. However, the two subtypes in this game are pitchers and batters. Both pitchers and batters look nearly identical with a couple of different stats. Pitchers will have a control number at the top of their stat box that's used when determining who has the advantage during an at-bat. Below that will be what type of pitcher they are, starter, relief, or closer. You have to start a game with a starter, and if you make a substitution, you have to go to either a reliever or a closer. Below that is what hand the pitcher throws with, either right or left-handed. This info can be used by strategy cards, which I'll get into in a moment, and also determines which hand switch hitters bat with, as they'll bat the opposite of how the pitcher pitches. So a switch hitter will bat left-handed against a right-handed pitcher and vice versa. To the right of that is how many innings they can pitch before taking a penalty. Basically, you'll subtract one from every pitch he makes for each extra inning he's in the game. So if Greg Maddux is still pitching in the ninth inning, he'll subtract two from your roll for each pitch. You'll still add the control number to your roll. The final number for this part of the card is a point number. When constructing your own deck, your team's total point value can't exceed 5,000 points. At the bottom of the card is a list of batting results with numbers next to most of them. When batting, the pitcher will roll a die and add their control number to the result and subtract anything for going over their number of innings pitched, and compare it to the batter's on-base number. If the pitcher's result is higher than the batter's on-base number, the pitcher has the advantage. Otherwise, the batter does. The batter then rolls a die and compares the result to this box on the pitcher or the batter depending on who has the advantage. You'll compare the number rolled by the batter to this box to see what the result was. For instance, if Greg Maddux has the advantage and the batter then rolls a 14, the batter will be out via a fly ball. Batter cards have similar stats on them, but they are a bit different. First up is an on-base number, which, as already stated, is used to determine who has the advantage during that bat. Next is their speed, which is used specifically by strategy cards when someone is attempting to steal a base, or just when they have to roll against speed or their card actually refers to the speed. When the defense has to roll against the player's speed, they have to be a 20 if the player has speed A, 15 for speed B, and 10 for speed C. When someone plays a strategy card that allows for a stolen base attempt, the catcher rolls a die and adds their arm rating to the roll, more on that in a moment. Plus they add another 5 if the runner is stealing third. If the total beats the runner's speed, the runner is out. For the record, you can't try to steal home. To the right of the speed box is how the batter bats, left-handed, right-handed, or switch. This is similar to a pitcher, but with only a single letter, L, R, or S, instead of LHP or RHP for pitchers. Below that is their field position and fielding bonus. A player can fill the positions listed and can gain a bonus depending on their position. For instance, Hamilton has a field position of OF, meaning he can play any outfield position. Your players must be able to legally field every position. The fielding bonus is used with strategy cards that require a fielding check. In those cases, the defense will roll a die and add those players' total fielding to that roll. If the total is 21 or more, this check succeeds. All pitchers and catchers have a plus 0 fielding, but the number listed for the catcher is his arm rating I mentioned a moment ago. A couple of quick notes for fielding. First, a player with a field position of DH is a designated hitter. A designated hitter doesn't qualify for any field position. Well, except for one, but I'll get back to that in a moment. If the home team is the American League, both teams get a designated hitter. A designated hitter bats in place of the pitcher. Any player may be a designated hitter, but if that player ever takes the field, then that team loses their designated hitter, and the pitcher must now bat for the rest of the game. The other note on position is the expert rules for first base. Any player may play at first base, but add a penalty. If a position player plays at first base and he doesn't qualify for that position, his fielding is minus 1 instead of what the card shows. If a designated hitter plays first base, his fielding is minus 2. The box at the bottom of the card is the same as on the pitcher, but is used if the batter has the advantage during an at-bat.
Whew. So, strategy cards. These are played during certain points in the game. The three types are offense, defense, and utility. Offense and defense cards are played when you're on that part of the inning, while utility cards can be played at any time. If both players want to play strategy cards at the same time, the defense goes first. Strategy cards will have their title, and below that, they'll tell you when they can be played. So, for instance, the card Bad Call can be played when a batter is out due to rolling a number that results in a strikeout. Below that is the card's ability. In the case of Bad Call, once again, you'll discard a card, then re-roll the swing using the same chart you did last time depending on whether the batter or pitcher had the advantage. And then, as I stated earlier, the bottom right corner shows what part of the field you have to be on to use the card, either offense when you're up to bat, defense when you're out of the field, or utility when you're either batting or fielding. Keep in mind that strategy cards are not used unless you're playing the advanced or expert rules. Just playing the basic rules, you don't have to worry about them. When it comes to building your team, i.e. constructing your deck, the manual says you have to decide whether you play by American League or National League rules when at home, or with or without a DH, but it doesn't say your team has to be comprised of just one league or the other. The two small starter decks my set came with is split between the two, but with the wording in the manual, I'm guessing you can mix the two leagues for team building. Your team has to have exactly 20 players, and you can field a starting lineup of 9, including a designated hitter. So I assume with that wording, you can have a starting lineup of 10 players if one of them is a DH. You must be able to fill all positions on the field without any backup players, which are any extra players on your roster that you designate as backups. The backup players will cost 1/5 of their listed point value, but before the 7th inning, you can't take the field if you have any backup players in your batting order. If you have a backup player pinch hit before the bottom of the 6th, you have to replace them with a regular player when your team takes the field again. Relief and closed pitchers don't get the 1/5 discount as it's already worked into their point values. Back to team building, you must have exactly 4 starting pitchers. You can't have more than one of the same person on your team, your players must have a total point value of 5,000 or less, and then you need to write down your lineup and backup players. I think that's about it. Oh, yeah, the strategy decks. You can build a 40-card strategy deck and a 15-card sideboard, because I don't think there are many Wizard of the Coast card games that don't let you sideboard. The main deck must be exactly 40 cards, and if you use a sideboard, it must be exactly 15. You also can't have more than 4 cards with the same name in your decks. With all of that, I think we're finally done with the card types and deck construction, so let's take to the field and see how the game is played.
So now we've taken a look at the different card types and the insane deck construction rules, let's go ahead and take a look at the basic rules of the game. These are going to be printed on both sides of the playmat, and there is still one or two things I'm a little weary about. For starters, the basic rules don't mention anything really about a designated hitter. So, for the basic rules, we're not necessarily going to worry about that right away. We're also not going to worry about making sure that you can fulfill every field position with your team. That will come further in the advanced and expert rules. So, to start things off, you're going to go ahead and find your pitchers. Each of the two sets for the starter set I have two pitchers, a starter and a reliever. So for the American League here, you have David Cohn and Buddy Groom. I apologize, this looks a little weird because I've got the camera in a weird spot here. And they will go on to your bullpen. Same thing for the National League, where we have Greg Maddux and Pedro Bourbon. Again, I'm kind of looking at this from an angle because of how I have to do this. After that, you're going to take your lineup and go and kind of start filling out the batter spots from 1 through 9, and you're going to put them in order of their point value, which I've already gone through and done. So let's go ahead and fill up all the spots here. Now what's interesting is that, like I said, this didn't mention anything about using designated hitters for the base rules. So what we're going to do is, for the base rules, from what I can tell, and again, I'm not seeing anything otherwise, we are going to fill all 9 spots, and then anyone left over, which we have one, will go on the bench. And will, in the base rules, to my knowledge, not get used. So I'm saying this is kind of weird, in that While there's no mention of a designated hitter, the base rules just say to go ahead and fill all nine spots on the batting order. So, the base rules don't really matter one way or the other in terms of designated hitters, make sure all the field positions are full. It's just having nine batters and a pitcher. And so that's the basic setup for the basic rules. Now for this game, the National League team is the visiting team, so they will come to the plate first, meaning that you take your pitcher for the your starting pitcher for the American League and you put them on the mound. The way the mat is positioned, it almost looks like there's two home plates. That's only so whoever's at the bat can easily see their stuff right side up. So since National League is up the bat first, this is considered second base. When the American League is up the bat, the pitcher will be facing that way, and that'll be second base. So in this case, the National League is going to take their first batter, which is Doug Glanville of the Philadelphia Phillies, and put them at the bat. And then the pitcher is going to roll the D20 to see who gets the advantage. So they're going to be adding the D20 roll to their control number, and if that number is higher than the batter's on base number, pitcher has the advantage. If it's lower or tied, the batter has the advantage. So we roll the number. 15 plus 5 is 20, definitely beats a 19, or definitely beats a 9. And something I've noticed with a lot of these cards is that the control or the on-base numbers seem a little low, so it's almost like more often than not the pitcher's going to have the advantage. So next is the swing, and the batter will now roll to see what happens. And the batter rolls a 16. Now, since the pitcher had the advantage, you actually look on their chart to see what 16 is. And in this case, a 16, as you can see if I can point out there, is a walk. So in that case, Doug Glanville will go to first on the walk, and the next batter comes up to bat. And essentially, that's pretty much the basic rules. So I'm going to go through a quick inning here, just to kind of see if I can show off like outs and everything else, and how runners advance. So the pitcher's roll in this case is a 4, plus 5 is 9, and Jeff Jenkins' on-base number is an 8. So pitcher still has the advantage. Jeff Jenkins will roll. He rolls a 10. Looking on David Cone again, a 10 is an out via ground ball. Now, in terms of the different types of outs, those don't mean anything for the basic rules. Other than out, walk, single, double, homer, whatever, the only thing to really give more explanation about is the single plus result, which I don't know if any batter has a single plus. So you can see how Jeff Jenkins has a single plus in his results, but there's no number next to it. A single plus means that you get the single, and then if second base is open after that single, he steals second. In this case, he is out via a ground ball, which again, the out type does not matter for basic rules. When a batter is out, go ahead and flip them face down, and just bring the next batter up to the plate. So once again, Cone will roll. Rolls a 7 plus 5 is, or 17 plus 5, which is 22. Definitely more than 7. Basically, if the die roll is higher than the on-base number at this point in the basic rules, the pitcher's going to have the advantage. So, Raul Mondesi, I'm about as bad as pronouncing certain baseball player names as I am anime names. So he'll go ahead and roll. Rolls a 9, comparing on David Cone's chart. A 9 is another out. So Mondesi will go ahead and flip face down for out number 2. Alex Ochoa comes up to bat. Same thing. Rolls a 17. 17 plus 5 is 22. Greater than the on-base number of 10. So Ochoa rolls a 1. And on Cone, a 1 is an out. Pretty much on Cone, a 1 through 15 is going to be an out. So in that case, that's the third out. So what you will do now, Ochoa flips face down. Any runners left stranded, go ahead and put them back face up. And you can go ahead and flip the other batters face up again, or face back up. But leave your third out face down. That way you remember where you left off in the batting order. So Cone will go back to the bench. Greg Maddux comes up to pitch. And we'll go and do a quick inning for the American League. Hopefully, we can get a result that actually results in advancing runners beyond a walk. So first up is Matt Stairs. Go ahead and roll for Maddox. Maddox rolls a 3, plus 5 is 8. 8 actually ties Matt Stairs' on base of 8, which means the batter actually has the advantage for once. So now Matt Stairs goes ahead and rolls for the swing. Rolls a 17. A 17 on Matt Stairs is a home run. So, don't have to worry about rounding the bases. That is a straight up home run. And the American League is now up 1-0. So, Tony Bautista comes up to bat. I mean, I know I wanted to show how runners advance. A home run was not really how I expected that to happen. So, Maddox goes ahead and rolls for the pitch. Rolls a 17. We know the deal by now. 17 plus 5 is 22. Definitely higher than the 7. And this is hard to play with a mat on a bed. So, Bautista will go ahead and roll. Rolls an 11. Looking on Maddox, since the pitcher has the advantage, 11 is pretty much going to be about the same thing. Anything 1 through 15 is going to be an out. So, Bautista is out for out number 1. Butch Husky comes up the bat. And repeat. The pitch for Maddox is an 11. It's already higher than... I'm just dropping dice now. That's already higher than Butch Husky's 7. So, Husky rolls. 16. And a 16 on Maddox is a single. Alright, so Husky goes to first, and hopefully now we can actually demonstrate advancing. If we don't by the end of this, I'll quickly explain how base runners advance. So, Maddox goes ahead and makes the pitch. Pitch is an 11, already higher than Sexton's 6. There's a 6. Sexton goes ahead and rolls for the swing. Gets an 8, and of course, going to Maddox, that is an out. So he is out number 2. So Lee Stevens comes up. Please hit anything. I want to demonstrate base running. So Maddox pitches for 12, already higher than 7. Stevens bats anything that's 16 or higher, please. Nope, 11. And Stevens makes the third out. So, once again, side retired. Husky comes back. Everyone else but Stevens flips over to show where he left off in the batting order. Maddox goes back to the mound, or back to the bullpen. Cone comes up to pitch again. And we left off over here with Darrell Hamilton. You can go ahead and flip Ochoa back up. And that is an inning in the basic rules. So for base running, basically, easiest way to explain base running is when something happens with the batter where they advance a base, all base runners will advance that many bases in the basic rules. So let's say there was a runner already on second and Hamilton got a single. Then Hamilton would advance to first and the runner on second would automatically advance to third. If Hamilton got, or somebody got a single plus result, I mentioned that earlier. Or if you get a single plus result, you advance to first, and then at that point, if second is empty, you steal second. If there was a runner on first, when Hamilton got a single plus, they would go ahead and advance likewise, but because there was a runner on second, Hamilton wouldn't be able to steal. Now, in the previous example, if there was a runner on second, and Hamilton got a single, they would both advance, and now since second is open, Hamilton on a single plus would steal second. When it comes to walks, the basic rules don't say anything about how walks work, but according to the glossary, it works just like in real baseball. So, if Hamilton walked, say he went to first, next up was Hernandez, and let's say he walked, he would go to first, and that would force Hamilton to second. Now, let's say, Hamilton got a double. He ended up on second. Up comes Hernandez. And let's say Hernandez walks. Hernandez would go to first, but since there wasn't already someone on first, you can't force a walk any further. Hamilton would stay on second. To my knowledge, that's how walking works in this game. But that's essentially it for the basic rules. So we will be back in just a moment and throw in a few more things for the advanced rules. Now we've taken a look at the basic rules, let's go ahead and throw in some more advanced stuff. And we're going to start with probably the biggest addition to the advanced rules, and that is the strategy cards. Each player will have a deck of strategy cards, and you start off with 3 of them in your hand at the start of the game. Then, at the beginning of every half inning, not counting the very first inning, so pretty much starting with the bottom of the first, each player will draw one card from the deck at the start of each half inning. So you start the game of three, then the start of each half inning afterwards, you draw one. As stated during card types, only players who are at bat can use offense cards, and only players who are in the field can use defense cards. Anyone can use the utility cards at any time. And it'll say specifically on the card when you can play them. So, taking a look at the National League's hand here, since they would be up to bat first. Their hand consists of a defensive card, full windup, which they cannot use because they are not on the field. A utility card, right, which they could use, called Change in Strategy, which allows them to draw three cards, then discard three cards. And they do have an offensive card called Do or Die, which stays to play before the pitch. It says, if your batter is a pinch hitter and he gets the advantage, add +5 to the swing. If he doesn't get the advantage, subtract 4 from the swing. And we'll talk about pinch hitters here momentarily, because I believe that's also part of the advanced rules. So they do have something that they can do on offense. And looking at the American League, their hand, they pretty much have a handful of offense cards. They can't really do much of anything. Basically, to play a strategy card, you go ahead and play face up, do what it says, and there you go. A couple things to keep in mind as to when exactly you can play strategy cards. First, you can play strategy cards only during an at-bat. Second, you cannot play strategy cards between the pitch and the swing. So once the pitcher rolls for the pitch, you can't play strategy cards between that and when the batter swings. Third, you can play strategy cards after rolling for the swing, but before carrying out the result. So there is a card that, I can't remember what it's called, it allows you to re-roll, or that allows the batter to re-roll his swing if he got an out, or if he got a specific kind of out. If both players want to do something at the same time, the defense gets to go first, the team in the field. If they're both thinking about doing something at the same time, the defense has to decide first. If your deck ever runs out, just shuffle your discard pile to make a new one. And if a strategy card changes a player's stats and doesn't say for how long, leave it on that player for as long as they stay in the game. Now, there are some more advanced rules in here that I'm going to go over. The manual actually does say that at this point, don't keep going with the advanced rules until these situations come up. So I'm just going to go ahead and briefly read through a few of these here, and then we'll do an inning or so with the strategy cards and see how well they work. And I'll probably reshuffle the American League deck, because that kind of sucked for them being on defense first. So the first one I've already talked about in the basic rules, though technically it didn't take effect then, and that is player positions. You must be able to field every single position when you take the field. So basically, you have to have a catcher, first base, second base, third base, shortstop, left field, center field, and right field. And obviously, you've already got your pitchers. Now, some players can fill more than one position. So, for instance, a Joe McEwing for the St. Louis Cardinals is pretty versatile, as he can technically play four different positions. He can play second base, or he can play anywhere in the outfield, henceforth what the OF stands for. That means you can play any of the three positions in the outfield. Also, as stated earlier, if a player specifically says DH, they are a designated hitter, and with one minor exception, they cannot play anywhere in the field. The only exception I mentioned during card types is first base, and they actually take a penalty by being on first base. So you also see, as I stated during card types, different bonuses depending on where they are for different checks. And if a designated hitter is playing first base, whatever that number is now becomes a -2. As mentioned, anyone who is actually a catcher, bat rating is actually their arm rating, and they have no fielding rating, so to speak. And in the advanced rules, fielding is only used by certain strategy cards when you have to make a field check. So to make a fielding check, the defense will roll a die, and they add that player's total to the fielding roll. And the total is 21 or more, the check passes, 20 or less, it fails. I also mentioned during card types having to deal with speed. When the defense has to roll against a player's speed, the number they have to be is 20 if the runner has speed A, 15 if it's speed B, or 10 if it's speed C. Now, some strategy cards can have a runner make a stolen base attempt. When you play one of those cards, you say who's trying to steal, and the catcher tries to throw them out. The catcher rolls a die and adds their arm to the roll. If the runner is trying to steal third, the catcher adds another 5 to the roll. If the total beats the runner's speed, they are out. And if it doesn't, they're safe. And you can't try to steal home. So again, that number all depends on their speed. 20 for A, 15 for B, or 10 for C. Next up is innings pitched. So a pitcher stays in the game longer than they should will start to wear out a little bit. And they'll take penalties on their pitches. So Greg Maddux, for instance, he can pitch 7 innings before that penalty. Then for every inning after that, so pretty much, for instance, the 8th inning, he'll subtract 1 from every pitch they roll. And then in the 9th inning, he would subtract 2. The last couple things to mention are substitutions and then bats and throws. So for substitutions, the defense can make a pitching change whenever it takes the field or whenever a batter comes to the plate. Whenever a batter would come to the plate, the offense can send up a pitcher or a pinch hitter instead. In both cases, the new player takes the old one's spot in the batting order, and the old player cannot come back into the game. You have to finish making substitutions before anything else happens. So, if someone wants to make a substitution, no one can play strategy cards until everyone's done doing that. If you send in a new pitcher, they have to be either a reliever or a closer. Much like you can't start the game with a reliever or closer, you can't end the game with a starter. Well, you can't substitute for another starter, so to speak. So if you really wanted to, you could end with a starter, and there are cards that actually help with that depending on how well you do on the field. If you bring in a new pitcher in the middle of an inning, that uses up one of their innings pitched. So let's say this is not the world's greatest put together starter deck, because Greg Maddux has an inning pitch of 7. But the reliever, Pedro Bourbon, only has inning pitched 1. Which means, we're in the middle of the 8th. And we decided to go ahead and substitute out Maddux for Bourbon. Bourbon comes in, and even though, let's say, there was already 2 outs. So Bourbon comes in the 8th inning, already got 2 outs. This is already his 1 inning pitched now. Which means in the 9th inning he would take a penalty because he is beyond his 1 inning pitched. A pinch hitter does not have to qualify the position the old batter was playing. Just remember that your team still has to fill all the positions the next time it takes the field. If your lineup cannot fill all positions when your turn to play is over, you have to make more substitutions until all the positions are filled. So finally are a couple things for switch hitters. Some strategy cards check to see how a player bats or how a pitcher throws. As mentioned earlier in card type, switch hitters will bat left against right-handed pitchers and right against left-handed pitchers. For game purposes, all pitchers bat the same way as they throw. So that's pretty much the gist of the advanced stuff. Not a whole lot. But I'm going to go ahead and also briefly go through some setup rules for the advanced game. And sadly, with the cards I have, I can't really show this. I probably could if I made this as one big deck. Which you probably could. Well, sort of. I don't quite have all the cards. So basically for a full game setup, a lot of this might be depending on if you're playing in a league or a tournament, but first thing you would do is you'd see who the home team is. And if you weren't given rules for this, then you roll to see who the home team is. Like if you're in a tournament or a league, and they didn't specifically say who the home team is, just roll to figure it out. Next, you will see where you are in your pitching rotation. If you weren't given the rules for this, the home team rolls a die. On 1 through 5, both teams' first starters pitch. On a 6 through 10, their second starters pitch. 11 through 15, their third starters do. And then on 16 through 20, their fourth starters. Next, you'll see whether you're playing by American League or National League rules, which, again, will designate who gets a designated hitter, if you get a designated hitter or not. If you weren't given rules for this, use the rules the home team prefers. So it'll be up to the home team. Now that you know who the home team is and where you are in your rotations, you can both change your starting lineups if you wish. Then write down and tell your opponent what your starting lineup is and make sure your opponent's lineup fills all the positions and then you start the game. I didn't really go much more into actual construction in terms of like point values, who's considered a substitute, and so on. I mentioned a lot of that in card types as well. So now we're going to go ahead and do a quick little game with, or quick little inning or so with the strategy cards, which sadly is not going to cover 90% of what I just said, because I can't really demonstrate a lot of what I just said. A lot of it has to do with, like, well, depending on the strategy cards that come up, we can probably work something in, just kind of give an idea of what the cards are like. So same thing as before, the National League will be batting first, so we'll go ahead and bring David Cohn to mound, and we're going to put Doug Glanville up front. So I did say I was going to shuffle the American League's deck a little better, and hopefully we'll actually get three decent cards to start. So they're on definitely a lot better. So now we have three defensive cards, so definitely good for this demonstration. So the ones I have two full windups, which I can play before the pitch. If there aren't any runners on base, you add two to the pitch. And then pitch out is play on a single plus result or other attempt to steal without a throw. So I'm going to back that up. Play on a single plus result or other attempt to steal without a throw. And then your catcher tries to throw out the stealing player. So for instance, I could just go ahead and say, just for help, before the pitch, we'll go ahead and play full windup, which will add to my throw. And over on the batting side, the only offensive card we had was do or die, which I can play before the first pitch. If your batter is a pinch hitter and he gets the advantage, add +5 to the swing. If he doesn't get the advantage, subtract 4 from the swing. But we don't have any pinch hitters yet. So instead, I'm actually going to go and play change in strategy, which says I can draw 3 cards and then discard 3 cards. So 1, 2, 3. And let's go ahead and discard. We can go and discard do or die. Let's discard a copy of full windup. And then we'll go to rattled and discard that. So we'll keep the two we have. And that's all we're going to do for now. So we go ahead and Cohn rolls the pitch. Pitch is 11 plus 2 for 13, still beats 9. So Glanville, go ahead and swing, base it off of Cohn's box. Get a 14, which is an out via fly ball. Again, outs, the type of outs still do not matter for the advanced game. So next, we're going to bring over Jeff Jenkins. There is... we're going to go ahead and actually play another strategy card. We're going to play Rally Cap, which I played before the pitch. At +1 to every swing this inning until someone gets out. Probably should have done that last time, but... well, that's kind of stuff that happens. Nothing else we can really do here, except if we want to, we can play another full windup to get +2 to this pitch again. So now Cohn will go ahead and roll. And rolls a 9. It's a good thing I actually played full windup. Well, actually, it doesn't really matter. 9 plus 5 is 14, plus 2 is 16. That beat the 8 plus 1 is 9, so Jenkins will be batting off of Cohn's box. Rolls an 18, which is a single. So that still actually got a hit off of that. Next, we're going to bring in Mondesi. This is still in effect until the end of the inning, or until someone gets out. Yeah, until someone gets out. So that's still currently in effect. Neither player will do anything. Cohn will go ahead and roll. Rolls an 8 plus 5 is 13, which beats 7 plus 1 is 8. So Mondesi will go ahead and roll against Cohn's stat box there. Rolls a 7, which is an out via pop-up. And next we'll bring in Ochoa once again. Same thing, neither player was really going to do anything. I mean, if anything, the only person who could would be over here. With the pitch out card, but there's not going to be a situation where that's going to come up, because even if Ochoa somehow got a single plus on the 17, that would just advance the two runners. Second would not be open, so Ochoa couldn't steal second anyways. So no sense in playing the pitch out card. So cone rolls. 15 plus 5 is 20. Definitely going to be 10 plus 1 for 11. So Ochoa rolls against cone. Gets an 8, and that is a pop-up. So Ochoa is out. Once again, Ochoa ending the inning. The cards used are discarded, which is, this is kind of pretty much a discard pile. Cone goes ahead and goes back to the mound. Each player will now get a new card from the strategy deck. And I kind of got these a little backwards here. Let's do this just kind of keep things a little straightened up. We'll put the decks over here and the hands over here. Okay. And we're going to do a quick round with the American League up the bat. We're going to put in Maddox. And Matt stares to bat. And same thing, just kind of the other direction. We're going to go ahead and do a full one. Actually, no, we're not. We're going to hold off. So Max will go ahead and roll. Roll 16 plus 5 is 21. Definitely beats an 8. Stairs, don't think there's really anything he can do. Nope. Well, given the cards he has, he's not going to be able to do anything for a while anyways. So go ahead and rolls. And gets an 8. And on Maddox, again, pretty much anything up to 15 is an out. So Matt Stairs is out. Tony Bautista comes up the bat. Neither player's going to do anything again. Maddox rolls. 16 plus 5 is 21. Bautista swings against Maddox's box. And gets his 7, which is an out. Next up, we have Butch Husky. Same deal. Maddox rolls. 14 plus 5 is 19. Husky gets a 2, which is an out. So, pretty quick half inning. Max goes back to the mound. Cone comes into play. Both players get another strategy card. And that's essentially how strategy cards are used. And with that, that's pretty much it for the advanced rules I can actually go ahead and discuss and actually show. Which I know wasn't much, but at least tried to explain what I could. I will go ahead and do a brief example and get a setup of how like stolen bases would actually work, though. So I'll be back in just a moment with that. So I've got a little bit of a setup here just to kind of show off potential for stealing bases. So we have Richie Sexton on second base, David Cone on the mound, and we're going to go and bring up Lee Stevens to the plate. Now, before Cone makes his pitch, we're going to go ahead and, the American League is going to go and play runner not held, which states you play before the pitch, and you make a stolen base attempt using a runner on first or second. You can steal a base only if it's open. So we're going to have Sexton tries to steal third. So first, that is discarded. So in this case, we'll go ahead and roll, and our catcher is Henry Blanco, who has an arm of plus 8. So we're going to roll and add an 8, or add 8 to it, and it has to beat Sexton's speed of B, I think it said yes, which means it has to be a 15. So we're going to do 8 plus 12, which is 20. Which in this case it does. So Sexton would be out. Now, if Sexton has succeeded, actually I backed that up. Sexton is still out, by the way, but I forgot to add something. Since Sexton is trying to steal third, that's an additional 5 that gets added to that roll. So technically the roll would have been 25. Even still, Sexton's out. He goes back on the back into the dugout or whatever you want to call it down here, the lineup. If he succeeded, he would have just went to third. Now, if he was going from first to second, he still would have been out because 12 plus the catcher's arm rating of 8 would still be 20. And he has a speed of B, or speed of B, which means he has to be a roll, or need to be a check on 15. So, he still would have been out trying to steal second. But that's essentially how stealing a base works. Now, what about though if the batter has a single plus? So, let's say Stevens, actually let's get a better example here. Who do I have here? Here's a single plus. Do I have nobody that can go? Yes, I do. So, Delino, the Shields, on a 19 can get a single plus. So, let's say he hits a single plus, he'll go to first, and if second's open, he'll steal second without a throw. I think one of these guys did have a card. Yes. So, in this case, after the batter rolled, it came up, let's say the batter had the advantage, he rolled, came up 19, single plus. After that, then the defense, if they had the pitch out card, could go ahead and play it. Which states you play on a single plus result or other attempt to steal without a throw. Single plus is an attempt to steal without a throw. And your catcher tries to throw the stealing player out and use the normal rules for stolen base attempts. So, again, saying that came from over here, I'm putting it here so I know what that came from. Saying the National League played that, and Del Shields had a single plus result, now it would be like a standard throughout the steal. So normally to be on first, and to make the check to see if they would succeed, 8 plus the catcher's rating of 8 is 16. Del Shields has a speed of A, which means they would have to beat a 20. 16 does not beat 20, and they would actually advance successfully to second. If they had beaten the 20, then Del Shields would have been out. And that's essentially stealing. And in a way, that's pretty much it for strategy cards. So everything from here on out, afterwards, in the next segment, is going to be, besides me knocking things off the mat here, it's going to be a few things for the expert rules. So the last couple things to talk about here deal with the expert rules, and I unfortunately can't really show much of this. It's more or less just a few things here there about what you can do at certain times. So for instance, expert player positions, as I've mentioned before, in the expert rules, anyone except a pitcher can play first base, but players who don't qualify there will have a terrible fielding. If the position player doesn't qualify first base, plays there, his fielding is minus one instead of whatever says on his card. If a DH plays first base, the fielding is minus two. They might be thinking with all the different cards down here in the lineup. When you have people playing, or that say on the card, they can play anywhere in the outfield. They have LF, RF, they can play left field, right field, center field, whatever. How do you know who is playing what specifically? Well, keep in mind you're supposed to be writing down your lineup at the start of the game. So you'll write down specifically, I would assume, who's batting when, so pretty much your batting lineup, your designated here if you have any, and who is playing what position specifically to make sure that all positions are covered. Next up is expert base advancement. So as mentioned earlier in the basic and advanced rules, singles advance runners one base, doubles two, outs never advance runners, and in triples and home runs will drive in any existing base runners. For the expert rules, though, on a single, a runner on second will always score. On a double of two outs, a runner on first scores if they have speed A. On a fly ball out, and this is where the different types of outs will come into play, on a fly ball out, a runner will score on third if they have speed A or speed B. And obviously this is assuming that this is not the third out of the inning. On a fly ball out, a runner on second advances if they have speed A and third is open. On a ground ball out, runners on second and third always advance. And of course, like I just said, runners never advance if the result is the third out of the inning. Now as for innings pitched, in the expert rules, a pitcher's innings pitch goes down if they give up a bunch of runs. So for every three runs a pitcher gives up, his innings pitch goes down by one. This penalty applies as soon as the pitcher gives up the third run, even though it's the middle of the inning. So let's say we are in the seventh inning. So let's say we're in the sixth inning, and David Cone has given up the third run of the inning. His innings pitch number would go from 6 to 5, meaning now he now takes penalties, because, well, he's beyond his innings pitched, if that makes any sense now. In the expert rules, relievers and closers cannot pitch every day. If you're playing several games in a row, you have to give them a day off once in a while. Again, this is probably more for leagues and tournaments. If a reliever or closer pitches two games in a row, his inning pitch start at zero the next game, which means you subtract one from his pitches right away. One day of rest is all a reliever or closer needs to get back to his full innings pitched. So, what about for... There's a couple things, strategy-wise in baseball, that I've not talked about yet, and that is intentional walks and sacrifice bunts. Or bunting in general, really. So after substitutions are over, but before you start playing strategy cards, you can call for intentional walks or sacrifice bunts. First, the defensive manager must decide whether to call for an intentional walk. Then the manager on offense decides whether to sacrifice bunts. If you do either one, there is no pitch and there is no swing. You can still play strategy cards at the usual times, though. You also carry out the results as follows. If the defense calls for an intentional walk, the batter simply walks. This is not a walk result for the purposes of strategy cards, but otherwise it works the same way. So in other words, the batter will still go to first, but anything that may have to do with a result, a roll result being a walk, doesn't actually take place here. Next, if the offense calls for a sacrifice bunt, the batter is out and all runners advance one base. You can sacrifice bunt if you have a runner on third, or if the batter was intentionally walked. So in other words, you can either sacrifice bunt, or basically you can only choose a sacrifice bunt, again, if there is no one on third, and if the defense did not call for the intentional walk. Next up is expert substitutions, which includes how to use pinch runners and defensive replacements. Now for the record, I'm going to be reading most of this verbatim from the manual. The expert game adds two kinds of substitutions, pinch runners and defensive replacements. All substitutions are made at the start of an inning or at the very start of an at-bat. You can't make a substitution if it would mean your team can't fill all the positions the next time it takes to field. Remember that in the expert rules, anyone who isn't a pitcher can play first. When you send in a pinch runner, he goes to the base where the old runner was and takes the old runner's spot in the batting order. When you send in a defensive replacement, he takes the old player's spot in the batting order. He doesn't have to fill the old player's position, though. You can juggle players between positions to make room. Just be sure everyone winds up playing somewhere they qualify for or at first base, and that all the positions are filled. You can combine two or more defensive replacements and pitching changes into a single substitution. If you do, the new players can take the old player's batting spots in any order. So for example, if you bring in a new shortstop and a new pitcher at the same time, the new shortstop can take the old pitcher spot in the order, while the new pitcher takes the old shortstop spot. This is often called a double switch. So as mentioned, the expert rules are where the four types of outs come to play. Ground balls, fly balls, strikeouts, and pop-ups. And I mentioned how ground balls and fly balls can lead to advancing runners, and ground balls can also lead to double plays. I'm assuming that's via strategy cards because I've not seen anything else in here about double plays. Actually, I'm going to take that back because looking at the glossary, it specifically lists double play. In the expert game, if a batter hits a ground ball with a runner on first, the runner is out. The defense tries to throw the batter out also. The defense rolls a die and adds the infield's total fielding to the roll. If the roll beats the batter's speed, they are out, otherwise they're safe. So basically, you're making a field... If there's a runner on first, batter hits a... ground ball, the runner's out, and then they try to basically make a fielding check to throw the batter out. However, to my knowledge, I don't think there is there is no actual triple play in here. It'd be interesting if they tried to come up with a rule for that. I guess, the only way I could think of trying to make a triple play is if you have runners on first and second. And this is just something off the top of my head. Runners on first and second, batter hits a ground ball. Runner that was on second is now out. They make a fielding check to get a runner out that was on first going to second. And they make a normal fielding check there. And then they make one more check against the batter, but only if the batter maybe has, I don't even know what speed you would want to do. Maybe speed C? So, like, if it's a very slow runner, maybe? I don't know. I can see them trying to come up with a way to do triple plays, and it'd be really hard to. Beyond that, though, if your batter gets a ground ball when first base is empty, they're out. If you have someone at first, the defense, I just read that. I did not even realize that the following paragraph on different kinds of outs was for double plays. So the final thing to go over is the complete at-bat sequence for the expert rules. So first, you take turns deciding whether to make any substitutions. Next, in the expert rules, the defense decides whether to intentionally walk the batter. Then, the offense decides whether they're going to sacrifice bunt if they weren't intentionally walked. Next, you will take turns playing strategy card or passing. Anything that is allowed to be played before the pitch is played now. Next, you roll for the pitch unless there is a pitcher at the plate. So basically, if a pitcher is at the plate, you don't roll for the pitch. The pitcher always has advantage. Then you'll go ahead and roll for the swing. Don't carry out the result or the swing for a couple moments here. Because next, or that, and obviously, for any intentional walk or sacrifice bunt, you don't worry about swinging at all. Next, you'll take turns playing a strategy card or passing. Strategy cards played on a certain kind of result are played now. Then you'll carry out the result of the swing, intentional walk, or sacrifice bunt. And finally, you'll take turns playing a strategy card or passing. Any strategy cards that can be played after a hit, out, or walk is played now. And that is essentially it. Again, the expert rules don't really add much to the gameplay itself other than the results of things like outs, throwing in walks, intentional walks, sacrifice bunts. So there's not really a whole lot I can actually physically demonstrate. Including things like actually making a full proper team, because I've definitely not got the cards for that. I've only got four pitchers total, and you have to have four starters. I could fill every position with both teams. But yeah, the two decks that are involved in this starter set were definitely made for the basic rules. And the manual even says that once you get the basic rules down, add in strategy cards, and then only bring the rest of the advanced rules when something calls for it. So if you're not sure what something does, go ahead and look up in the advanced rules instead of trying to remember it all at once. And the expert rules, again, are just a few things about substitutions, sacrifice bunts, intentional walks. Those two, I'm surprised, aren't in the advanced rules. But yeah, that's pretty much it for this. I've got a couple thoughts about this, and I'll get to them in just a moment when we get to my final thoughts on the game. So that's pretty much it for MLB Showdown 2000. So overall, my thoughts on this is that it can be pretty complex at first. Once you read the rulebook a couple times and start understanding a few things, it starts to get a little easy to understand. I'm not going to lie, trying to take something like baseball and turning it into a trading card game, I can imagine that's not the easiest thing in the world to do. And overall, I think they did pretty good with what they could do, trying to make sure they incorporate everything, including if you're doing like tournaments or leagues and you're playing on multiple days, like resting your closers and your relievers, rotating your starters. They really did what they could with this, to turn baseball into a card game. And overall, I like it. Then again, I'm a fan of baseball. Not to the point where I completely keep up with stats and everything like that. But I do enjoy watching it from time to time. And if you want to pick this up and give it a shot, at the very least, the cards that you get with the two-player starter set, you can use for the basic and the advanced rules. But you will need more cards for the expert rules. Given that it's Wizards of the Coast, the way I see it is that, yes, you get basic rules, you get advanced rules, but if you remember, I can't remember if these are still on the different Magic the Gathering products, where they, because it's been a while since I've bought any, where they have, like, the little ovals that'll say, like, starter, advanced, expert, or whatever, and the expert icon was usually on the booster packs. That's kind of what I imagine this lot being like. Like, you have the very basic rules. You have stuff you can put in for more advanced rules. But if you want to do anything with the expert rules, you need to go out and actually buy booster packs to get more players, put them in there, customize them a little better, and so on. But overall, even if you did just the basic and advanced rules, they did a pretty good job at incorporating what they could into, or from baseball into a card game. So if you're a fan of baseball, you're a fan of card games, you can find this on the cheap, I'd say pick it up and give it a shot.
Though it has me wondering now, has anyone tried to make a football trading card game, or basketball, or hockey, or any other sport into a trading card game?
I'm sure someone has, and I just haven't come across it yet. Probably Wizards of the Coast. So with that, I thank you guys for watching, and I will see you next time.
Hey everyone, thanks for checking out my look at MLB Showdown. If you came out of this video confused about a few things, I don't blame you. I have the basic rules down and can throw in most of the advanced stuff, but once you hit the expert rules, I think my brain just starts to implode on itself. Maybe over time I'll start to remember them better, but for now I'll stick to the basic and the advanced rules. Anyway, if you're new to my channel, I try to do a few different types of videos, such as game reviews, let's plays, and blind runs of games, or even just the occasional video taking a look at a game I have lying around my room that I haven't even opened up yet. With that, I thank you all for watching, and I'll see you next time.